Thankful he's the everlasting God. He's not grown weary in the midst of anything going on in this world. Coronavirus has not taken him by surprise. He's got a cure for that. And he is able to just fight for us in the midst of our biggest struggles that we could ever face. Wonderful advocate we have in the Father. He's the defender of the weak, and he comforts us and lifts us up on wings like eagles. What a wonderful word to hear this morning. Let's just continue to sing about our Lord as we sing, "I Stand in Awe of You."
You are beautiful beyond description, too marvelous for words. To you.
I want us to think about that thought real quick, just for a minute. I yield to the Spirit. We yield to the Spirit. We're talking about our aspect in the call to intimacy from last week to the knock to this week, the hunger that stirs within us. Holy Spirit, we do this morning, just as we saw in the psalmist, we give our entire heart. We pour out our heart. You remember the woman in the New Testament named Mary who poured the expensive alabaster perfume, poured out. And if you remember, the disciples are looking, and Judas is like, what a waste, what that could have been used for. And all the other disciples begin to also join in, and, well, why would she do that? And everything she could have done. And Jesus sees the beauty of a moment in that pouring out of the sacrifice of thanksgiving for what she had experienced because of Jesus. She poured that out upon Him and then cleaned with her own hair. And Jesus said, this will not be taken. This will be talked about for years and years to come. And we still talk about that story. We pour out our heart in this morning, Spirit, in the sense of what it means for us to yield, is that we are pouring out our sacrifice this morning to You for what You have done for us. As the Spirit this morning testifies that we are a child of God, I want us to just continue to worship in that spirit of sonship, of being a daughter, that He has invited us into this relationship. He has invited us into this life with Him. I no longer live, as Paul says, but Christ lives in me. We yield this morning. We surrender. We pour out our hearts to You in this moment. This time that we worship together, may it shake the ground that we stand on. We stand in awe of You. We continue to pour out right now, just as we continue to worship Your name. We pour our hearts out. We continue to pour out the sacrifice at Your feet, Jesus. We thank You. Can you put that lyric up again that said my broken song for your perfect, if you can find that slide. There. The moment I sang this, it just stirred within me. I come with my broken song to you, who's the perfect one. We come with our brokenness. But you're perfect. Jesus is not a religious concept. He is a relational reality. This is what we talked about last week. He's not just a religious concept. He is a relational reality, real. The perfect one. We're not trying to pursue things of religion. We're trying to pursue Jesus. There's a difference. And it may just seem like, as the song says, my broken song. But it's to the perfect one. And when it reaches your ears, it's a beautiful sound. It's a beautiful aroma to you. And we thank you this morning that that is what you call us to. It's what you desire. We're not here for a performance. We're here to see your power. That anything is possible. Well, that's what we're going to be looking at in Scripture today, the hunger. And Father, we know that you satisfy. And so we come today to the door. We're at this door of intimacy. And we know that we come hungry for more of you. And your love does not run dry. We want to come empty so that we can be filled. We come to a feast. We come to a feast ready with a hungriness. We want to be able to eat and take part in this great feast. And so we need to stop snacking on other things that are filling us up, because there's something that you want to fill us with, but there's no room for it. And so we come hungry today. Help us to understand how to grow in hunger today as we continue to pursue after you. We thank you. We pray in your name. Amen. Amen. Before I get going, just want to make a couple notes for us as our church. Next Sunday is Cindy's last Sunday with us. Chris is already down in Alabama there and working. So next Sunday will be Cindy's last Sunday with us. So she reminded me, and as they transition to their new chapter. Also, another good friends of ours that will be transitioning is Patty and Kevin. They kind of been in this for a little while of moving closer to their kids and grandkids in Texas, and they put their house up for sale a while back, and in the last week it finally was sold. And looking around February time here for the closing, and as they transition down to Texas to be closer to their kids and grandkids. So but we wanted to make that aware for those who didn't know. I think they may have put something, I don't remember, but at least we can continue to pray for them as they begin that next chapter to Texas, as they look for a house. We know the Lord will provide that. And so we're praying for you guys, blessings, as we got a few more weeks with them, though, and then they'll be on their way to Texas. So, well, we're talking about the door of intimacy. We started this last week, and something that I was reading, wasn't in my thoughts or notes for today, but I started to read it actually this morning while we were practicing, Ezekiel chapter 33. Just listen to this, because I think it just goes so well with what we're going to look at today, though, and what we looked at last week and just to come. Ezekiel 33, the prophet is writing this, and it just begins, "The son of man, your people talk about you in their houses and whisper about you at the doors. They say to each other, 'Come on, let's go hear the prophet tell us what the Lord is saying.' So my people come pretending to be sincere and sit before you. They listen to your words, but they have no intention of doing what you say. Their mouths are full of lustful words, and their hearts seek only after money. You are very entertaining to them, like someone who sings love songs with a beautiful voice or plays a fine music on an instrument. They hear what you say, but they don't act on it. But when all these terrible things happen to them, as they certainly will, then they will know a prophet has been among them." And I think it's just a fascinating thought, the people coming to hear Ezekiel just to be entertained. And that seems to be sometimes the mindset people take within churches. You know, we come to be entertained. We want good music. We want good good programs, we want everything that meets our needs, but no one actually comes for a hunger to hear the word of the Lord and actually act upon it. And I believe as we talk about this year, that is the call. I believe it's the invitation that we looked at last week. The invitation is to move past the comfortability and the complacency that we maybe have fallen into, and to really pursue the reality that God is here, God is relational, and He desires something deeper with us. And so it's time, I believe, this is what I was getting from this morning, I think it is time that we quit pretending and be sincere as we come before the Lord. What the Lord lays on my heart every week, and I always pray that I'm able to reciprocate that, my heart to you as the Lord lays it on me, but that we would come each week with an intention to do what the Lord shows us. And so that's Ezekiel, and I use that this morning just to get us going in the direction that we're going to be looking today. I want to read again. This is the scripture that we looked at last week, Song of Solomon, chapter 5. Let me just recap, because we're going to pick up in this again this week, talking about hunger. So last week we talked about the knock at the door, Song of Solomon, chapter 5. This is, I believe, an image that we can get of the bride, which is us. We need to rekindle what it means to be the bride of Christ. That's the point of this entire door, is to regain, to rekindle what it truly means to be the bride of Christ. And so it says, I slept, but my heart was awake when I heard my lover knocking and calling, open to me, my treasure, my darling, my dove, my perfect one. You know, the other night, I was trying to be romantic to Tiffany, and I was like, your eyes are like doves. And it got me nowhere. She just said, ha ha. But I was trying, right, babe? I was reading too much into it. Okay. So we can try, but I think we'll just leave this to speak about the dove, and maybe we'll get there next week. But really, the image of the dove, the beauty of the image of the dove in the New Testament with the Holy Spirit. But open to me, my darling, my dove, my perfect one, my head is drenched with dew, my hair with the dampness of the night. But I responded, I have taken off my robe, should I get dressed again? I have washed my feet, should I get them soiled? My lover tried to unlatch the door, and it says, my heart thrilled within me. I jumped up to open the door for my love, and my hands dripped with perfume. My fingers dripped with lovely myrrh as I pulled back the bolt. I opened to my lover, but he was gone, and my heart sank. Here's what I want us to look at today is in verse 6. It says, this is what I want to see. I searched for him, but could not find him anywhere. I called to him, but there was no reply. And then it says in verse 8, make this promise, if you find my lover, tell him I am weak with love. That thought came with me all week this week about lovesick versus being offended. That thought stuck with me. I just want to share that. That we as people of God would be less offended and we would grow more lovesick. Because of the things that distract us, the things that get in the way of receiving of him, that when that is hindering that, and we're not, that we would grow lovesick more, and people would grow less offense to the things God is doing. But I want to talk about this idea of hunger, the I searched for him, I called to him, and this aspect, what I want you to understand is that the hesitancy cost the presence in that moment when she didn't open the door. But now, all of a sudden, the heart is being stirred. Comfort is no longer the issue as she loses sleep and risks going out to search to find. And we sang a song this morning that's based on Psalm 42, As the deer pants for living water, so my soul longs for you. My soul searches for you. Where can I go and meet with him? Psalm 42 is I believe it's the call as we talk about what it means that we're going to lose some sleep. We're going to risk the safety that we can search for him. We need to move past the comfort of complacency, and we're going to begin to search, what does it mean to grow desperate in hunger for him? Two things I want you to think about as we journey through this today. Number one, we looked at it last week. Jesus promises to eat with us, and I believe that is an invitation to those who are hungry. Jesus promises to eat. Revelation 3:20, we're going to read it here in just a minute. But the number two, I want you to think about this. The Holy Spirit lands on the heart of the hungry. The Holy Spirit lands on the heart of the hungry. So let's look at this in Revelation chapter 3. I'm going to read a little bit more than what we did last week. Last week, I just looked at Revelation 3:20, but today I want to look a little bit further up, and I want to get the context of this invitation about hunger. Revelation chapter 3, verse 16. You know, in Scripture, there's three states of the heart. There's, in the New Testament, we find when Jesus was on the road to Emmaus and the two were talking, it says their heart burned within them. We're going to look at another scripture this morning, Matthew chapter 24, verse 12. Jesus warned that in last days, people's hearts will grow cold in love. And then in Revelation chapter 3, verse 16 through 20, he talks about the lukewarm heart. So there's three states of the heart that we can be in. There's a cold heart, a hot heart, a warm heart, or there's a lukewarm heart. And we know the lukewarm heart is that one that's kind of in the middle there, where Jesus said, you're neither hot nor cold. And he says, I would rather you be one or the other. I would rather you be hot and warm and burning with zeal, or I'd rather you just be cold, because when you're lukewarm, you're blind and you don't realize that, in fact, there's nothing there. And lukewarm is really, it's the state of the believer that's the most difficult, because we don't actually realize the true condition we're in. When you're hot, do you know you're hot? When you're cold, you know you're cold. But when you're lukewarm, when you've grown to that lukewarm place, you don't really realize it. And that's what Jesus is talking about in Revelation chapter 3, is that the church had grown lukewarm in love. Let's take a look at it. Revelation chapter 3. Jesus says, for I know, this is verse 15, I know all things you do, that you're neither hot nor cold. I wish that you were one or the other, but since you're lukewarm water, neither hot nor cold, I'm going to spit you out of my mouth. One translation puts it, I'm going to vomit you. I think that's a pretty strong image of what Jesus thinks of when the church becomes lukewarm. Have you ever drank your coffee? You let it sit too long and it kind of gets right in that middle. Jim's back there. His face made it all. I wish we could have had that on camera, because I think that would have been perfect. get a picture. Let me say it again. Back up real quick. That face, it was perfect. That's exactly what happens when we drink lukewarm coffee. Ugh. Ah. Ah. And you what do? You throw it out. That's what Jesus is saying. When Jesus tastes the lukewarm church and he sees the lukewarm church, that's what he does. He vomits. He spits them out of their mouth. And verse 17 says, you say, so this is the condition of the church that he's writing to, the church of Laodicea. You say that you're rich. You have everything you want. I don't need a thing, and yet don't realize that you're wretched and miserable and poor and blind and naked. So I advise you to buy gold from me, gold that had been purified by fire, and then you'll be rich. Also buy white garments from me so that you will not be shamed by your nakedness, and ointment for your eyes so that you'll be able to see. I correct and discipline. Listen to this. I correct and discipline. We have to grow lovesick. This is what Song of Solomon chapter 5, when he says, if you find my lover, tell him I've grown lovesick. He corrects and he disciplines everyone he loves. Don't grow offended towards Jesus. So be diligent and turn from your indifference. And then verse 20, look, I stand at the door and knock. Look, do you see? Look, we have to get the ointments for our eyes so that we can see. We need to drop aside that we think we have everything. We have to drop aside our self-sufficiency and says, look, I am at the door and I knock. If you hear my voice and you open it, I'm going to come in. I'm going to share a meal with you as friends and you with me. The initial hunger, you know, I call it the honeymoon. You know, when people first get married and we talk about the honeymoon. And then, you know, after a while, people then say this comment, you know, the honeymoon season ends and then marriage starts. You know, you get married and you're so in love and you have no clue what you're doing and everything's great. And then they eventually say the honeymoon phase ends. But I remember one time I was talking to a gentleman. I don't know, him and his wife, I don't know how long they've been married, forever. And I remember him saying one time that they were still honeymooning. And I was like, well, isn't that supposed to end like forever? And he goes, it doesn't have to. And I thought that was so insightful. You know, we think because we, and it's kind of this, we get the gift of salvation. You know, we receive Jesus and we give him our life. And then it's like, you know, we get all excited at first and people are so on fire for God. And then for some reason, we feel like we have to fizzle out. You know, we get that initial and then it goes away. I love seeing Christians still. No matter if you've been a Christian for 1 year, 10 years, 30 years, 40 years, whatever, to still feel like you're in a honeymoon with Jesus. Amen? That passion is still there, but this is what happened. Revelations 2:4, we looked at it. I hold this against you. You've forsaken the love you had at first. You've forsaken the love. And then in Revelations chapter 3, it says, you say you're rich. You've acquired wealth, but you don't need anything, but you don't realize, listen, you're wretched, you're pitiful, you're poor, you're blind, you're naked. And so you need to come back, and you need to buy, it says, gold refined by fire so that you can become rich. Get white clothes to wear that you can cover your shame, and the salve or the ointments to cover your eyes so that you can see. And so the apathy of the church found in Revelation chapter 3, verse 20, left them in a condition. And the only currency, I want you to get this, I think I said it a few weeks ago, the only currency that allows us to move on from this condition, the currency of heaven, is desperate hunger. That's the currency of heaven. That's what's going to bring heaven into the church. That's what's going to bring heaven into your life, is desperate hunger. But if there's no hunger there, then we become satisfied with other things. Here's what hunger does. I want you to get this. This is what hunger does. It causes us to empty ourselves of compromise and creates a dissatisfaction that drives us to our knees and makes us depend more on God. God said, turn from all of that and come to me. Let me give you the things that you need to come back. But there has to be a state of dissatisfaction in something. I think that's the biggest issue we have today, is that people just aren't dissatisfied with what is going on. This is what we saw last week in Song of Solomon, chapter 5, that the hunger eventually exceeds the hesitation. Hunger eventually has to exceed hesitation. A lot of people stay in that hesitation for too long. He's at the door, he's knocking, but we're hesitant. Do we really want to open that? But let me show you, the first thing about hunger is being aware of it. And here's what hunger does. When you become hungry for God, when you begin to get that stir within you, as we saw in Song of Solomon, when it begins to stir you and you realize there's something discontent there, there's something that's missing, and you begin to say, I have to go find. And that's the greatest place to be, when you say, I need to go search, I need to go look. When you go to church and you do all your things and you still feel like there's something missing, here's what happens. The things and activities that used to bring comfort begin to lose their attraction. And it begins to get replaced. Those unhealthy substitutes no longer satisfy you, and you're looking for something else. I was thinking of it this way, that this week, that it would be like me. I know, let's say, take Thanksgiving or Christmas, or just any other day. There was a family that we knew back in our last church in Illinois. Every Sunday, their family had a gathering, a lunch gathering. They always had a huge meal, and every now and then we got invited to that, and it was awesome. And so you know the feast is coming. You know this huge meal is coming, but you choose to snack leading up to it. You're snacking the entire time leading up to that. You know the feast is coming. You know there's going to be so much food, and you want to be hungry. You want to have an appetite to eat everything you can, but instead you choose to snack the entire time leading up to it. And when it comes time to eat, you're not hungry. You're full. And I believe that's the image of Revelation, is that we don't feel these manifestations, these strong manifestations for God, because we have nibbled so long at the table of other things that when it comes time for the things that God wants to do, we're not hungry, because we're being filled with other things that temporarily make you feel satisfied, but then make you hungry again quickly. But you keep doing that, and never at the table to feast. I want to feast at the table with the Lord. I want to read two scriptures from the book of Jeremiah to help us see this next point. The greater the capacity to be filled, the more desperate our hunger will be, which means we've got to make room for hunger. That dissatisfaction part is where we begin to push out things that are hindering us from that stirring or longing. Here's how Jeremiah gave it. Jeremiah chapter 2, verse 13, he says, "My people have committed two sins. They have forsaken me, the spring of living water, and have dug their own cisterns, broken cisterns that cannot hold water. So they have forsaken me, who is the source of water, the source of life, the source of your being, the foundation. You've forsaken, neglected that, and you've dug down to your own cistern. But what you don't realize is that your own cistern has a hole in it that cannot hold water. And so constantly, while we're trying to fill our lives with something else that's not Him, the entire time it has a crack in it, and it's never being filled." Listen to then, this is what Jeremiah 14:3 then says, a few chapters later. "The nobles send their servants for water, and they go to the cisterns, but find no water. They return with their jars," here it is, "unfilled, and they're dismayed and despairing, and they cover their heads. So we have built, we have dug our own cisterns. We haven't realized that there's a hole in it. We come back to try to fill up our water just to find out that it's broken, and we're left, what it says, jars unfilled. We come back with nothing. You ever heard, let me just say it. Have you ever heard the statement someone says, I go to a church and I'm not being filled? Their jars are unfilled. It's because they're coming to church trying to look for their own thing to fill themselves. They're not looking for God. I truly believe no matter what church you go to, if you truly desire the presence of God among the people and you're truly searching for Him in the moment of a worship service, your jars can be filled. Doesn't matter if there's 2 people there, 2,000 people there. If there's a guitar player, an organ player, I truly believe with all my heart, if we're going there to search, listen, He is the spring of living water, Jeremiah 2:13. He is the spring of living water, enough to flow. But what have we done? We've dug our own cisterns. We have our own paradigms. We have our own mindsets of when we go to church, here's what it has to be. Here's what we got to get. If it's not there, then I'm left empty. I'm not being filled. Left dismayed, left despairing. And they cover their heads. The greater the capacity to be filled, the more desperate our hunger will be for Him. What's your capacity to be filled? Luke chapter 5, we looked at this a few weeks ago about the wineskins. And what we have to remember is that our relationship with God is not something simply added to our life like the extra pair of cloth that Jesus expressed. We don't sew the old cloth over the new one over the old. Jesus isn't just something that we're trying to add into the midst of our lives. He says we have to get rid of the old, we have to get rid of the old wine so that we can make room for the new wine. The capacity to receive what heaven wants to do has to be first met with a dissatisfaction of what I'm currently doing so that I'm hungry for what He's going to do. Amen. And so, verse 20, Jesus waits at the door to be invited in. The condition of the church of Laodicea is not too far off of the condition of many churches today. The quality of what we are is going to be in direct proportion to the holy desire that we have for Him. That makes sense? He wants to be longed for. He wants us to be like the deer we sang and we read in Psalm 42, as the deer pants, as the deer longs for the water to drink, my soul longs for You. Don't we want our souls filled? Matthew chapter 5, verse 6. Jesus said, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. What is the equation? Barbara Gage, if she's watching, she loves her equations. We were talking about this, I think, two weeks ago on Wednesday night Bible study. We were talking about, I was making some points in Bible study, and she was trying to simplify them for the group. That's kind of what she does. And so I was just thinking of this Matthew chapter 5. Hunger What's the equation for being filled is to hunger and thirst. Hunger and thirst equals being filled. What's interesting about the kingdom of God when we live in that, typically in the physical realm, the more you eat, you get filled, right? But yet in the kingdom of God, the more you eat, really, it stirs a hunger to eat and eat and eat more. Hunger and thirst for righteousness, which means we hunger and thirst after Jesus. We want his righteousness. And when we thirst for that, Jesus said, you'll be filled. So the question progression is this. Number one, can you say to Jesus, I not only want you, but I need you? I need you. But then I want you to take it to the next step. Not only do I need you, but I must have you. I must have you. It's not enough that I just need to eat. Desperation is, I must. I must. There's times in life where we must do things. There's a desperation to it. I'm talking about a hunger that is more than just a normal hunger. I'm talking about a desperate hunger. That's what we need today. That's what Jesus is inviting us into, a desperate hunger. I must have Jesus. Jesus says, those who are filled, listen to this, are not those who have their hunger and thirst met, but it's those who are continually hungering and thirsting. Jesus said, blessed are those who hunger and thirst, for they will be filled. Not blessed are those who hungered and thirst, and they were filled. It's not a, I did it once and it's a done deal. You've just cut the honeymoon off. You've ended the honeymoon with Jesus. The intimacy is gone. We got married. I got saved. That's all there is. That's religion. That's what religion teaches us. We need God, and that's it. Everything else will just be what it be. But Jesus is inviting us into not a concept, but a reality that continues in our life. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst, for they will be filled. We've not been filled yet, so we're hungering, we're thirsting, and then we're going to be filled. And when we're filled, we're going to hunger and thirst more. The more we get filled, the more longing we're going to have to empty to be filled again. It's an ongoing process. That's what is different between moments of seasonal revival when we have something at one point and a sustained culture of it, is because we are constantly longing, constantly hungry and thirsting for the new wine. Never satisfied, always longing. What do we need, and where do we choose to eat it? This is why we can go to church and serve and yet still leave unsatisfied and feeling. Because the essence of hungering for righteousness is having a desire for identity in Christ alone. And that develops intimacy that then pushes aside distractions that do not satisfy our hunger anymore. What is it that's distracting you from experiencing the essence of the hunger and righteousness alone in Christ? About a month or so ago, we looked at this story, 2 Samuel 6. You don't have to turn there, but I want to remind you when David dropped the ark off at a man's home named Obed-Edom. He didn't know what to do. They were carrying it. I forget the man's name that touched it and died. And David really grew anger in him that the Lord did this. So he left the ark at the home of Obed-Edom. And for the time it was there, his entire household was blessed. Eventually, David hears about this. In verse 12, it says that he brought back the ark because he desired the presence again. When he heard about what the Lord was doing, when he heard about the presence of what it was doing, what it did was it stirred within him the hunger of his heart again, that he wanted that for the entire nation. He wanted what God was doing in the home of Obed-Edom for the entire nation. When God begins to do that, when God begins to pour into one person or two people or whatever, and you get a sense of what God is doing, you want that for the entire nation. That's hunger. And he desired and he brought back the presence to be close to the people again. This is what I want us to end in this thought, that the deeper we go into intimacy with Jesus, the greater the revelation we receive of love. The deeper we go in intimacy, the greater the revelation of his love we receive. Song of Solomon chapter 7 verse 10. I want to end with this. Song of Solomon chapter 7 verse 10. And this is what it says in the Passion Translation. I'll also read it in NLT. But in the Passion, it says this: "Now I know that I am filled with my beloved, and all of his desires are fulfilled in me." Here's what it says in NLT: "I am my lover's, and he claims me as his own." I am my lover's, and he claims me as his own. We're talking about, Solomon's talking about this, but he's using it in a way that we can portray to look at the church. The church of Christ, the bride of Christ, I know I am filled with my beloved, and all of his desires are fulfilled in me. When we get lost in him, we truly find ourselves. When we get lost in Jesus, you will truly find who you are. When Moses, in Exodus chapter 3, when God called Moses, did God have Moses look at himself to gain confidence, or did he look at God to get confidence? God said, "Here's who I am." Every time Moses said, "I can't do that because of this, I have something." And God said, "Well, who created that, or who gave you that?" In every moment Moses had an excuse, God made Moses intentionally look back to him to see who he was. Everything that we need is fulfilled in Jesus. When you get lost in him, when you look at him, we gain the better look at what we need to see in ourselves. Number two, this love expresses complete satisfaction. This love of his is the expression of complete satisfaction in Jesus. "I have filled with my beloved, and all of his desires are fulfilled in me." And number three, what it means that this love is the absolute rest that we have. I don't have to look for it somewhere else. My identity doesn't have to look towards something else to know who I am. Philippians chapter 3, Paul's testimony. I didn't give the scripture, but I felt like I needed to go ahead and read it. Philippians chapter 3. Just want you to listen to Paul's testimony, and then I want to pray for us. Paul said, we rely on what Christ has done for us. We put no confidence in human effort, though I could have confidence in my own effort if anyone could. Indeed, if others have reason for confidence in their own efforts, I have more. I was circumcised when I was 8 days old. I'm a pure-blooded citizen of Israel and a member of the tribe of Benjamin, a real Hebrew if there ever was one. I was a member of the Pharisee who demanded the strictest obedience to the Jewish law. I was so zealous that I harshly persecuted the church. And as for righteousness, I obeyed the law without fault. I once thought these things were valuable, but now, listen to this, I consider them worthless because of what Christ has done. When we move from Christ as a concept, when we move from religion over to understanding relationship, this is what you get, because verse 8, everything else is worthless when compared with the knowledge of knowing Christ my Lord. For his sake, I've discarded everything. I count it all as garbage that I may gain Christ and become one with him. I no longer count on my own righteousness through obeying the law. Rather, I became righteous through faith in Christ. For God's way of making us right with himself depends on faith. And I want to know Christ and experience the mighty power that raised him from the dead. I want to suffer with him and share in his death so that in some way or another, I will experience the resurrection from the dead. I love that. I love that. I want to know Christ and experience the mighty power that raised him from the dead. And that's what we're doing, Father. This door of intimacy, it's an invitation to understand the deeper revelation of receiving love and to live in that identity of what the beloved. We are in our lover, and he has fulfilled his desires in us. He calls us his own. We don't have to look anywhere else to receive this because we know whose we are. And so this hunger, this stirring that leads us to search is what we're about this morning. We want to work through our capacity to receive. And so maybe this morning there's some things in our life distracting that we need to get rid of so that we can grow in a hunger. We need to realize, as Jesus said, the state that we're in. You're wretched, you're poor, you're blind. Come to me and buy gold refined by fire. Receive white garments to cover your nakedness. Buy ointment to help your eyes. Father, we do our eyes, every part of our eyes, to see. We don't have to live with shame of nakedness. For Paul said, my righteousness is not through what I try to do anymore. My righteousness is in Christ by faith. We can live in that reality. And so we come to be hungry, to be filled. We come with desperation, a desire for more of what we don't have, the longing of more. I invite you to stand as we sing this. Come alive. Come alive. Dead hearts, come alive. Father, there's hearts that have grown cold today. As Jesus said in Matthew 24, if hearts have grown cold, we need revive. We want to know the power that raised Christ. We need the power today to raise hearts, to restore hearts that have grown cold. Lukewarm, we need something to help us to see the reality, the true condition that we have come to, the true state that we're in. We're blind. So move and breathe, breath of God. Breathe this morning. Breathe. Breathe.
Through the eyes of man, it seems there's so much we have lost. As we look down the road where all the prodigals have walked, and one by one the enemy has whispered lies and led them off the slaves. But we know that you are God. Yours is the victory. We know there is more to come that we may not yet see. So with the faith you've given us, we step into the valley unafraid. We call out to try. God of unrelenting love, rescue every daughter, bring us back the wayward sons, and by your spirit breathe upon them, show the world that you alone can save, you alone can save. We call out to dry bones, come alive, come alive. We call of God, now breathe, oh breath of God, breathe, oh breath of God, now breathe, breathe, oh breath of God, now breathe, oh breath of God, breathe, oh breath of God, now breathe, breathe, oh breath of God, now breathe, oh breath of God, breath of God, now breathe. Breathe, oh breath of God, now breathe, oh breath of God, breathe, oh breath of God.
breath of God, breathe. This morning, across your church, across our communities, just breathe, breath of God, breathe. Awaken. Give life. Just as it says that you breathe into the nostril of man, just as you gave life today, when Ezekiel saw the vision of a valley of dry bones, Lord, there are so many today who don't even realize, in the sense that they have dried up. And God, you're the only one who can breathe into them the fresh anointing to awaken, to revive. Just as we read here, I was asleep, but I was awakened. My heart was awakened. Father, we need an awakened people. Your church needs an awakened heart, that you are at the door and you desire deep intimacy, because there's a fruitfulness that you're wanting to bring, but we're barren. And I believe this year you are calling the church. I believe this year you're going to shift some things in the church. I believe you're going to bring such an awakening into the body of believers today. It is going to draw us out of the complacency, out of the comfort. It is going to draw us to realize there's a new wine and we need to break ourselves to receive. We want the breath of God. We want the breath of God. Breathe. 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 Across this world today, we thank you for the hunger. Thank you for hunger today that draws us closer to you, moves us away from other things, and sets our hearts to pursue you. We thank you today. We thank you today. The word that is a seed, may it be planted within our hearts and produce a harvest of righteousness for you. In Jesus' name we pray today. Amen and amen.